Take it away, Tyler.
Do we have everybody in here?
Nah, we're working through all that yet.
Well, just until they get in here.
Staying up to the coffee machine.
Yeah, so I can level set a little bit. That was the first time I got to see Warren's presentation. I'd heard about it ever since I started at Schneider. And I'm so amped because it was really good and insightful and interesting. We have different methods, but we're gonna talk about some similar things in terms of smart building and how that plays into the hospital side of things. So he's done his 400 times. I've done mine 0 times, and he's got a nice belt buckle. But aside from that, I think we should be okay. And hopefully we can learn some things here about smart buildings. So I'm gonna kick this off. My name is Tyler Haig. I work extensively with the consulting engineering community for Schneider Electric in the Northeast. And I'm fascinated by buildings and have been for a really long time. So I did my undergrad at Virginia Tech. I got into structural engineering. I figured I wanted to get into the architecture design kind of thing. Realized that's been being done for hundreds of years, and it kind of bored me. So I got a master's degree in energy and atmosphere engineering from Stanford because I felt that there was a big trend in terms of building technology moving in that way. And a lot of things that Warren said here today in terms of energy consumption on the rise, the ability to optimize the performance of buildings. But I think anybody who's observing their own personal lives in the world should realize that really a major trend in everything is connectivity and smarts. So I believe that in our industry we need to be transitioning much more towards smarts. The risk we have in a title like smart buildings is it becomes something that you hear so much that it's kind of in the background constantly, and you forget to define what that actually is. So similar to in our industry, you know, what's a green building? What makes a green building? How do you define that? I'd like to start with the definition for what a smart building actually should be. We will be leveraging data from interconnected systems with the express intent of enhancing customer experience. So we're talking data, connectivity, and customer experience. That's kind of the call to arms for smart buildings. The agenda today is going to be broken into 4 parts, and you'll hear people from Schneider Electric, or generally anyone talking about anything, describe a story. We've probably heard the word story, customer story, use case story, Schneider Electric story, over 100 times today. And I think, for those of you that are into the arts and literature, there's a nice model called the hero's tale. It's repeated in everything. Don Quixote, Catcher in the Rye, for those of us don't like to read like Joel, Star Wars, Harry Potter, whatever it is. And what that hero's tale is we have something, someone, who's in a comfortable environment, the way it's always been, eating grapes somewhere, good. And then a challenge approaches, some coming storm, that forces our hero out to some quest, a knowledge quest, player montage like in Rocky, something like that. Come back stronger and then implement that to change society and make things better. And in terms of where I feel buildings are headed and what a smart future means, we should be looking at what our modern building stock is and defining what buildings look like today and having been designed recently. The challenges that are approaching us in terms of connectivity throughout the world, not just in buildings but in our day-to-day life, and how we can solve that with smart building design focused on customer centricity. And then leaving with some action steps here in terms of, again, whoever the end user winds up being here in this presentation, what our next steps will be for how to work with Schneider Electric and why we feel we're positioned to help you guys. Okay? So if that sounds like a good idea, I'd like to start with modern buildings in our comfort zone. Modernity is a deal all of us sign up to the day we were born. It regulates our lives until the day we die. And what I think this really means is that, you know, you're born into kind of a native circumstance where you can take for granted what's around you and not think very often. That's what thinking inside the box actually is. It's the box you've been put in, you think within it. And so in our lifetime, in our industry, you can become complacent with the way that things have always been done, and you might need a little bit of a jolt, a reason to change. And there's another way to look at this that I'll refer to throughout the course of this presentation, which is a little David Foster Wallace story about these two fish that are swimming through the ocean, just doing their fish thing, swimming through the sea. And another fish comes by, and he says, "How's the weather today, boys?" And neither of the fish answers, they keep swimming on. One fish looks at the other one and says, "What the hell is water?" Or he says, "How's the water today?" He says, what is water? Because fish don't know what water is, it's just what they've always had. And in our industry, we're looking at things the way that we always have. What's going to be challenging us? So let's take a look at what modern buildings are. In short, they're the best we've ever seen. They're the same thing that we've always been doing, but they're the best version of that. And we've been focused primarily on the operational performance with high-end technologies. So we'll start to look at some of the systems that make up modern buildings, the technologies that come into play, and it'll be very similar to the type of things that we just saw Warren talking about. We'll start with HVAC and VAS control because that's what Schneider and my career is focused on. We have chillers and air handlers that every year are better and better, more efficient, use less refrigerant, find a way to use less energy, and so on and so forth. In controls, our logic has improved, we can communicate faster, and we're working with the American Society of Heating, Refrigeration, and Air Conditioning Engineers to be efficient, to use less energy, to provide the air changes that regulation requires of us, to meet those operational day-to-day tasks. Lighting, not all that different. The task with designing LED lights or CFLs is to be more efficient. We can start doing more things like dimming lights, and having different scene settings and potentially different colors that you might have in your own environment where you're living at home. On the security side of things and that kind of portion of the industry, our cameras get better and better. The megapixel quality gets better every time there's a new release. We have better wide dynamic range. We're able to do more as far as that goes. Our elevator systems, if we're focusing on commercial office buildings particularly, I know this is a sensitive subject for you, Callie, since you're afraid of elevators. But the elevator systems get better over time. And again, they're focused on end use case and also energy efficiency. How can I do less travel to move more people in less time? And then things like AV systems. So Warren came in here and said, I always bring my set of jacks so I can set up to whatever's in there. That's changing constantly. I have the same experience. Every office I get into, there's a new technology that's changing all the time. Every manufacturer in each of these industries would say, my product is as good now at doing what it's supposed to as it's ever been before. And that's the case, right? And what's nice about that is that it's inevitable that without being moved, we will see continuous improvement. This is the height of our comfort in modern buildings and what we've done. We know how to design, construct, and manage modern buildings the way that we always have. We've done this on the contractor side, the mechanical engineering side, the developer side. We want to repeat that as much as we can because we've learned and we feel like we're getting better at it. And the industry players who have all the money that are in all the buildings now and are able to move with the industry can continually do R&D and plug in better and better products over time, so we should see that happen. And then, of course, we have technology's favorite, Moore's Law. Don't know if people are familiar with Moore's Law. A quick background of it is essentially this guy named Moore, at the onset of the technology revolution in Silicon Valley, noticed that every 2 years you could fit double the amount of transistors onto the same chip. And that has repeated every 2 years since chips started about 50 years ago. It hasn't stopped. Ultimately, that distills down to we can expect technology will continually improve at or around the same cost that we're used to over time. Simply put, modern buildings are the best version of what we've always done, which is great. And that's why, you know, you wouldn't blame us for taking a victory lap for being in this industry. This is the best. We've never seen anything better. But there are some other things that we need to address, right, wrong, or indifferent, about how buildings work. Each of those systems that we talk about, the way they're typically designed today, based on the way that we've gone to market with the engineering community, the way we've executed projects, et cetera, highest class technology it's ever had, all of them produce and share data to inform what they need to do. So in building automation, we've got data flowing from all the field devices to our controls. The same is true for lighting, the same is true for access controls. Now, what Warren talked about a lot is silos. And I think silo is sort of a bad word in and of itself. What it means is that we're separating all of this data and keeping it together. So we have all this data, it's the best technology we've had, and it keeps getting better and better. But essentially, in most modern buildings, there isn't a lot of connectivity between those systems. So the silo is a good analogy for how our communication systems actually work. In most modern buildings that are currently under design, if we haven't been brought to the table early, or have been designed in the last 5 or 10 years, which isn't that long, but generally speaking, That's what we see, the silos. Now, these great buildings serve essentially three masters. They serve the developer, the management, and ownership team that is worried about ROI and making money, the business ventures that go into those buildings. It's focused on the customer, or the worker, or the inhabitant that these buildings are actually for in the first place, like us today. And then it focuses on the facility manager, who ultimately this team will measure and monitor and do day-to-day stuff with the buildings. So I would open this up to you, and I would ask you, who primarily benefits from this, the way we do buildings now, and are they correctly aligned? Would it be fair to say that we are 33% in the favor of the owner, 33% in favor of the customer, and 33% in favor of the facility manager when we sit down with our customers and we lay out buildings? Mm-hmm. Who thinks that that would be fair? Who would have a feeling that we might be doing it differently? What do you think, Bob?
I don't think that. You want me to give you my ratio?
Yeah, what would your ratio be?
I would say that the facilities manager is probably 5%. The CEO ownership group is financially, 75%, and then there's some middle ground for the customer. There's a couple benefits for the customer, but we talked about valued engineering, where valued engineering is not gearing finances towards the customer, it's for the ownership group.
I think that we do primarily focus on the ownership group and the facility manager. And here are some of the reasons that I would say the facility manager gets a little bit as well. When we sit down with our engineers or our owners, the facility manager gets brought to the table and conveys some of their desires and concerns and explains to us how they'll be operating the building. The owner, for sure, the owner is going to lay out a capital expense budget. We're going to have to figure out what goes in there. We'll have all these conversations about what's important. The customer doesn't really have a say, because who actually is the customer? When I say the customer, am I talking about a 22-year-old new hire? Am I talking about somebody that's been at the company for 35 years and has seen a bunch of stuff? There's a lot of different ways that you can talk about the customer. And right now, I don't feel like we get close enough to who that actual customer is in modern buildings. If you talk to the owner, they'll say, yeah, I want this. I want the ROI that I specify to you. I don't want all the bells and whistles. The end user probably wants some of the bells and whistles. If they could get the bells and whistles, they would get them, right? The facility manager, how many facility managers have you ever talked to that tell the story of the placebo thermostat they've put on the wall that actually didn't do anything but convinced the customer that it did? That's not customer service, right? So really, I think that we're working mostly in our service contracts and in our installations with the facility manager and the owner. Now, right, wrong, or indifferent, that's the current state of things. The question then becomes, if we look at operating costs once the building is in place, that 75% that Warren was talking about, and we start to analyze how we spend within that facility, in year 6 or year 7 after the installation, the costs are broken down in what's called the 1990 rule, roughly. 1% of that is going to utilities for, let's say I'm leasing a space from the 27th floor from a developer. 1% is going to utilities, 9% is going to my real estate cost of being there, and 90% is going to the people that are actually in there, which is a misalignment of what we actually just looked at. This is all great. Like I said, I have a background in energy and atmosphere engineering. We need to be more efficient for the sake of a lot of different things, regulations, the environment, et cetera, cost, of course. But what this shows us is that any change, good or bad, in how our people are performing or the work that they're doing in that space is 10 times more valuable than a change in real estate, and 90 times more valuable in terms of energy spend during operating costs in any given year in the facility, which kind of flips the paradigm on its head in terms of how we should be thinking about these things as we design them now. It's the type of thing that we should be considering and bringing to the attention of our owners and teams, because these systems are going to be in place for 15, 25, 30, et cetera, years. That makes customer experience and that kind of paradigm that we looked at what I feel is the largest challenge that's facing us in the deal we signed at birth, that modernity that I talked about previously. What we're seeing is customer choice prevails, and we see that customers are choosing access and experience. This isn't the first time that there's been disruption in the world. It's just that in our lifetime, this is one of the big things that we'll see. And there's a good analogy in terms of major disruption. Is anyone familiar with the Timken Corporation or Studebaker Brothers? Both companies exist today. Still now. At the time of Henry Ford coming onto the scene with the Model T, Timken was the largest manufacturer for carriage wheels, and Studebaker was the best manufacturer of carriages. So leading up to that innovation that changed the world, they were iteratively getting better and better. Their products were improving, and they were at the top of the market. But when disruption happens and cars come into play, it doesn't really matter what kind of carriage wheel you make anymore because carriages are done. Modernity has changed, history is being made. We look back at that as history now, but really what that is disruption at the time that it happens. Timken moved on to make tires for cars. They still exist, they're successful. Studebaker Brothers moved on to make cars. They still exist, they're still successful. A lot of companies did not. So a lot of companies died. In the face of what was happening. Now, if you look at, okay, what's happening in the world, here are some companies that are being challenged. Yellow Cab is being challenged by Uber and Lyft. Gillette is being challenged by Dollar Shave Club. Chase Bank. When's the last time that you bought a checkbook? You would like to send your stuff by text and Venmo. NBC, you've got cord cutters taking away from all the cable companies. Columbia Records, you used to have a stack of CDs in your living room that were all plastic, now you have Spotify. New York Times, everybody knows what's happening with newspapers being digitized. Postal Service, I can send you a letter in 3 days or I can send you an email and you have it immediately. That kind of changes the industry, doesn't it? Luxottica was the largest provider of glasses. Warby Parker, which I'm wearing now, has displaced that. Customer service. Airbnb with Hilton and hotel chains. Netflix took out Blockbuster because I have access to movies when I want it. We just saw Black Friday is down, Cyber Monday is up, right? The corner store gone out to Walmart, Walmart going out to Amazon. The bar used to be a great place to meet people of the opposite sex. Now that's Tinder and Bumble. And you've got education, right? You've got constantly growing costs for higher education that people are worried about. We can learn things all the time, whenever we want. So really, you could dig into any of these. I mean, my favorite is Gillette. They've got their own Gillette razor model that is proud of essentially screwing over the customer. Sell them a razor for cheap, or a razor for cheap and blades for whatever you can gouge them for. And Dollar Shave Club comes in and says, no, that nobody wants that. And ultimately, Dollar Shave Club is worth billions of dollars. So does this apply to buildings? Yeah, it's gonna apply to buildings because this is the world. Customer connectivity and access and experience is going to get into our field like anything else, in my opinion. And I think a nice way to round out this portion of the presentation is that I left off somebody that is being challenged by disruption now, and that is Ford. The Ford Motor Company that started that thing with Timken now has to figure out how to make self-driving cars or else they're out of business too. So it's not new. And we have to look at this and say, all right, where do we play? What is that challenge that's taking out of our comfort zone, that water that we're used to swimming in? For us, it is expectations of connectivity. So I have another quote that goes with this. No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. This is from that poem about how all humans are connected, and it's about, they used to ring bells when somebody died. It ends with, ask not for who the bell tolls for thee. Humans have always wanted to be connected. This isn't a new trend. That's why in the first place we had language, then we had cities, we had radio, we had television, we had phones, we have the internet, we have social media. It's a self-perpetuating cycle. It's just that now everybody is connected all the time. It's not gonna slow down. So that's something that will be challenging us in every facet of the world, and definitely in buildings, because the first thing I'd like to address is that 90 that we talked about, the customer of the future, and start looking at what that customer might actually be like. As we lay out buildings today in our room with the stakeholders that we have that are aware of the project, this is what we're going to be looking at. That operating expense of the 90, the people that live in the apartments or work in the office. We can start with demographics, and millennial is just a charged word, just angers people, right? Millennials, get a job, move out of your parents' home, Tyler. stop buying avocado toast and your fancy brunches and, you know, all this stuff. You killed Applebee's, etc. But millennials are also the most technologically advanced workforce that we've ever seen because we've grown up with technology more than anybody else has. Does anybody know when millennials will constitute the largest portion of the workforce in America versus all other demographics?
Right now.
2015. Yeah. So today, look around the room, right? There's a lot of millennials in the workforce now. Are we thinking about their demand for connectivity? Being a millennial myself, I can tell you that technology isn't necessarily native for millennials. Electricity is. When I was born, my house had electricity, right? I've always had it, it's what I'm used to. It is that water that I've been used to swimming in, right? But I can remember the day that we got a computer and got the internet, and I got an AIM screen name and was able to play Echo the Dolphin and stuff like that, because it was new and it changed my life. These guys that are coming around the corner and Generation Z, the water that they're swimming in is having an iPhone when they're two, right? And being able to swipe at all this stuff and interact with all of their surroundings. And that will continue to grow. The iPhone will be supplanted by virtual reality and all the different things that are coming around the bend. And if they were born halfway through the life cycle of the iPhone, they're five now, which means they're in K-12 schools, essentially now, they're in college in 10 years, and they're in buildings like this working in 15 years. So if we're starting a project now and talking about it 2 years before the construction of it, we need to be considering who's going to be in it and what their demands and appetite will be. Some of those things are going to be the ways we work will be different. We've already seen this with Skype. Everybody here's got a Skype account for Schneider Electric. We're going to be able to have virtual reality headsets so we can put one of those guys on and everybody sits in a meeting room together regardless of where they are in the world. Hyperloop transportation is going to make cities much closer together. So, for instance, I'm originally from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. They've laid out a couple routes of that first kind of hyperloop transit, these super fast trains. There's a route that they've got that goes from Pittsburgh to Columbus, where you're headed, and to Chicago. And it would take 39 minutes to get from Pittsburgh to Chicago on Hyperloop.
Wow.
Which essentially makes those cities suburbs of one another. Because there are people who live in the suburbs of Pittsburgh right now who drive 45 minutes or an hour in their car to get to work today. But they're going to be on a train and in Chicago in that same period of time. And then self-driving cars. Also in Pittsburgh, there are self-driving cars on the road right now. That's where Uber's doing all of their testing and stuff like that. That will change the nature of how we work. We'll be able to lease out cars for work purposes. We'll be able to work remotely more often. We won't be stuck on the road, driving around, focused on other things. And it's going to move us much more towards global hubs, which is something that's already happening. The UN reported that every day, 3 million people move to a new metropolitan area. Every day in the world. And that's been going on. The world is urbanizing. We talk about that a lot. It's one of our stories with Schneider Electric. That is a trend that we'll see. The workforces are scalable. There's going to be a lot more freelancing, sharing economy, gig economy, contract employment, and decreased loyalty. We've already seen that with millennial generations, just more fickle, more access, more choice afforded to workforces than we've ever seen before. So that's a trend that we should see continuing. And then higher competition for skilled work. Does anybody have a thought as to why I believe there will be higher competition for skilled work and why specialization will rule the day in the future? Yeah. So in the same way that jobs have been outsourced, we lost a lot of those jobs. The ones that aren't outsourced now are going to continually be eaten up, the more general they are, by automation. And what that's going to do is force us to be continually learning, retraining, and specializing. When you put all of this into a witch's brew cocktail of what the workplace of the future looks like, it's technologically proficient and interested in technology, it's wanting to connect, it's being highly mobile and urban, and it's also being specialized and in higher demand. So we really need to be thinking about that 90. Because I mentioned that if you change for the better or the worse, those 90 that are working for you, and they jump ship because you aren't meeting their demands for whatever reason, that really affects you. As I said, what was it, 10 times more than real estate and 90 times more than energy moving forward. You really need to consider the human component of the workplace of the future. And then in terms of the technology component of the workplace of the future, we've already seen two waves of the information technology digital trend. The first wave was mainframe computing and personal computing. So that was the big IBM computers that then became Steve Jobs sitting in a Lotus position with the Mac computer and Bill Gates doing his whole thing and people getting personal computers. And then what we've been living in now, which is laptops, iPads, mobile computing, e-commerce on your phones, all of that stuff. The third wave is really a blend between day-to-day life and technology, so that technology is informing us more and more about ourselves. We're essentially becoming cyborgs. So Warren showed the Fitbit. That's a great example of getting insight on your own personal health and self in ways that you've never done before by tracking technology and doing that type of thing. You're going to see much more of a blend between where humans end and technology begins. That's the third wave of technology. Right, wrong, or indifferent, however you feel about that, as I said, connectivity kind of rules the day. Now, that's cool, maybe buildings will avoid it, you proffer to me. But the truth is, we've already seen those first two waves of technology. We had pneumatic controls. As soon as we could get to computing, we did. As soon as computing got better, we got better. And that is now our edge method that we talk about in our tech stack. And you're also seeing your customers want remote laptop accessibility. They want apps. They want all this stuff. That is the second wave of digital technology. So I offer to you that I think it's wishful thinking to believe that in the building sphere, we'll avoid some of these major technological changes, and something we need to be thinking of now. What constitutes this third wave of technology is brought in with a couple other buzzwords that I'd like to talk about here. The first one is the Internet of Things. Kind of resonates in our background. We hear about it. Okay, IoT, Internet of Things, I already know what that is. But really, what the Internet of Things is in terms of smart buildings and the world that we're living in, we need to be thinking of it more in terms of raw material and resources for the information revolution. So in the same way that the Industrial Revolution couldn't have happened without coal and steel and furnaces and factories and all of that, all the mining and resource acquisition that we needed to do, the information revolution and what we're seeing happening really comes down to data mining. Data is kind of the new goal. We connect all of these devices and it makes them marginally more interesting or better, but it actually connects us to more products and allows us to start getting more insights. We're seeing this in our apartments. I've got a Fitbit and a smart scale and a smart AI assistant, smart thermostat, all this stuff in our day-to-day lives. And we've all got smartphones, but we're seeing more and more things connect. So, you know, of course, the toothbrush, the refrigerator, the outlet, the lock, et cetera, et cetera. What that means is that we're accessing more data and information. Where are we today? We're in 2017, which I think is this one. It's a little bit grainy. So we're around here. An example of that is this sign that I saw the other day. You can't see it, but it says Fitbits for Dogs. So that's where we're at today. Fitbits for Dogs is around where we are here on this curve, and we've got this hockey stick rise. It's not going to slow down. So if we're connecting dogs now, you can kind of imagine that there's going to be some more connectivity. So the question then becomes, cool, we're connecting all this data. What do we do with it? That's where the cloud comes in, another kind of term that's used very often. The cloud, what we're doing with that is taking all the data and using essentially limitless hard drive capacity. So we can put all those points in one spot. And as Matt was talking about today, and as Warren alluded to as well, this is where we run our high-level algorithms at scale with a lot of information in ways that we were never able to before, because you just can't get enough insights without enough of that fuel. So all of these points here are essentially your clusters of data. And this is where we're starting to use terms that you might think of, like machine learning, deep learning, or neural networks, which are actually specifically designed to emulate the performance of the brain. So when the brain registers a new piece of information or data, the neuron fires a signal to another neuron. And as connections build in the brain saying, hey, this is important, I need to learn it, we build more axons along that connection between those two neurons. That's how the brain works. That's why I'm not thinking about what I'm saying right now. Language is not embedded into my brain. But if I wanted to learn a foreign language now, I've got really weak connections between, okay, that's cheese, and in Spanish, that's queso, right? The point is connection. So we want to take all this data and figure out how it works together and connects. This berry here that I have in my hand, and I'm a forager, is it dangerous? Is it safe? Is this one rich in nutrients and antioxidants? I don't know, but I have to learn over time and then take that information to move forward. That's what we're doing when we talk about analytic platforms and AI. We're taking all these different types of information, making connections, putting together algorithms that help us deduce more information and then find out what's valuable. And the whole point of that is that we are in the business of providing value. And I think in terms of the second portion of this presentation, the crux of what we need to take away from it is that there's a difference between value and perceived value, and where we are in society right now and the way that the world works is different than what we've seen before where we just produce products. So what I mean by that is, you know the phrase, worth its weight in gold? Basically means, if I have a pound of gold, it's worth a pound of gold, right? That's the value of that pound of gold. But if I go, hey Brian, thanks for taking me around DC this work. I like the way you work with your customers, and it seems like you really care about what you're doing. I'm gonna bring you a pound of gold tomorrow. And I show up and I give you a pound of gold, then your experience has now met your expectations. Still 1 pound of gold, value is value, the perceived value is one. If I say, hey Brian, I'm gonna come in tomorrow, I got two pounds of gold for you. And then I show up with 1 pound of gold, same value. His expectation was 2 pounds, but he gives one. So his perceived value is less than one. He's not happy with me. Whereas if I say, coming in with 1/2 pound of gold tomorrow, and I find another 1/2 pound on the way to work, he expected 1/2 pound, he gets a full pound, now he's really happy with me. That's the perception of value, and we're in this to provide value, all of us, regardless of where our stake is in buildings. Now the question becomes, as we're constantly hit with new technology, like smart assistants that we've seen in the last few years, or Fitbits, which I think I used the exact same image that you used in your presentation, or smart thermostats at home that start to figure out where we are geographically and can kind of figure out how the temperature needs to be, or we can start using YouTube to program chips to serve as smart devices in our home, augmented reality, be able to impose the digital world over our real world. Virtual reality, where I can just go to a sandy beach within a few years whenever I want if I'm really stressed out. Self-driving cars, that we've always talked about, already talked about today. And then I just threw this one in here, the cover of Time Magazine's top 25 inventions of 2015 was this personal robot. That's just recently, and that's not gonna slow down. So really, in terms of technological appetite for the people we've talked about, you can expect that this expectation number is going to continually grow, and we're tasked with keeping up with it. And there's a couple different things that you could propose in buildings to look at expectations. One is you could say we'll do what we've always done. And I would offer to you that you'll start today at a value of one or a little bit over one, but those expectations are going to go up over time, and if you're siloed, you're not going to be able to do what people want. I think it's a bet that you might want to take for one reason or another, capital expense, etc., but it's a risk. The other is, we can give you everything now, an experience, and give you a 1,000 value building versus your expectation of one. But there's a couple issues with that. One is, it's obviously very expensive. The other is, our expectations are still gonna go up over time, so we're actually gonna have a diminishing perceived value, even though it's well over one, as the building runs. So the solution that we need to come up with is a platform, similar to what Warren talked about, that has the infrastructure capability of moving with the flexible new tasks that buildings are going to be asked to perform that we can expect through past experience over time. So as new things come into this bottom area here, our platform needs to be able to plug in with third-party applications. So we need to be nimble enough with enough bandwidth and connectivity and connection and communication that we can work with that. And that's the task that leads us to what smart buildings actually are. So when we get into, all right, here's the Holy Grail, here's what we're getting at, we need to talk about smart buildings and they are platforms. Two smart people, Mark Twain and Helen Keller. All ideas are secondhand, consciously and unconsciously drawn from 1 million outside sources. I've got a double entendre here for your pleasure. The first being, we talked about how these big insights that we're gaining about the world today are from millions of outside sources, much more than 1 million outside sources. The whole point of the cloud is the insights that we get are from all of those outside sources. That's the first part that you should think of when you think of smart buildings. The second part is, we're not coming up with something that's drastically new. This is a secondhand idea. We've made things smart before, and the greatest analogy, the easiest one, is the smartphone. I'm sure you guys have been assuming this since I've been presenting, but when I was in college 10 years ago, I was excellent with the ladies. I had three girlfriends. You've all been thinking it, I'm just gonna bring it up. Now, when I was in college 10 years ago at Virginia Tech, we didn't actually have smartphones yet. I didn't know anybody had a smartphone. But the girls that I knew, and specifically my girlfriend at the time, She had a Motorola Razr, and it was the first phone that I ever knew about because of what it did. It was really thin, so it could fit into a tight pair of jeans, and it had different colors. And it was the biggest thing ever when she got the Motorola Razr, and a lot of her friends and sorority sisters got the Motorola Razr. At the time, with what we knew about the water we were swimming in and what modernity was, it was the best thing that we had seen. It had a camera, it had T9 texting, so you could, you know, just press a button instead of having to press three or four buttons to get to a letter. It was revolutionary. And then the next year, when I was at grad school, the iPhone came out, to the point that 10 years later, if you still have a flip phone, you're at worst a joke, and at best, you have some quirks, right? You're like kind of that weird person with a flip phone. So why is that? Is it, what helps us wrap our head around what the big difference there is? And of course, the iPhone has gotten better over time, but the camera, whenever it was first released, probably wasn't that much better than what the Motorola Razr had, because that's what technology was. Really what it was a platform. Basically, when I say, if you build it, they will come, I mean, people will buy it, it's more interesting, but I also mean developers will come. Different parties and interests will come to say, how can I use this technology that you have to help provide a service for people? Because the platform is there, the infrastructure is in place that I can take advantage of it. I can use the GPS on my smartphone so that my Uber can pick me up, or so that when I'm using Waze, it knows where I am versus a cop that's down the road or how fast I'm going. I can use the camera to develop an app like Snapchat or Instagram or any of these things that are common vernacular today that couldn't have existed until the infrastructure was built. The infrastructure needs to be there first, and that's what smart buildings are. So let's take a look at what that digital stack might be. Here's a digital technology stack for Schneider Electric. We've already looked at this a little bit here today, right? We're connecting to all of our field devices, so we don't need to get into the nuts and bolts of the revolution that's happening there. But our new launch allows us to communicate at much faster rates of speed than we ever have been able to before. So we can connect more devices, more connectivity, more data that we can take to this edge level that we've always been at, or flip it up to that top level app analytic level, and start doing things like building advisor and doing cloud platform type analysis that Warren already talked about, or resource advisor, or any of the top level platforms. We can feed them into different vertical markets, as we've also seen today, with healthcare, hotels, office and commercial building, which you know I focus a lot of time on here in this presentation. And what we can do is essentially what we've always done. We connect the building, we collect all the information, we analyze what we're seeing, and we take action. But previously, if you're just at the edge level, then that really means you're analyzing that data based on your schedules, your alarms, and the trends that you're seeing at that site. Now, with this third wave of digital technology, we're connecting the building, we're collecting the data much faster than we've ever been able to before. We're analyzing it at scale and being able to do a lot more and gather greater insights so we can take more proactive, better action. And all of our industries that are in buildings are doing something similar. The question then is what I just described, is that even a smart building? I would say that what I just showed you, the answer to that is no. We just looked at Schneider Electric, only Schneider Electric's platform, and what we can do by connecting those devices, taking it to the edge level, doing all of the analytics and stuff in the cloud. And really, that is the best thing that we're able to do with modern technology. It is that third wave of digital computing. But until we can leverage that data from connected systems with a focus on customer experience, we're still in silos, and it's not really a smart building. It's just a better version of what we've done with higher level technology. So what we need, and again, I had not seen Warren's presentation before today, is something that looks more like this. Instead of a silo, it's a hub, right? And he had 23 different types of things that you could have on that hub. When I put this thing together, I was thinking about the systems that we've already discussed. But the idea being, I can say, I swipe in my card when I get to the commercial office building. I'm on one converged network where everything lives on one dedicated, strong, combined backbone. And I take that information and it puts me to the elevator that I need to get to. I get in the elevator, it sees that I'm going up, it turns the lights on in my office or sets the temperature in my office. I can use augmented reality glasses when I'm servicing a chiller. I can say, hey robot, I'm terrible at setting up AV systems before I give a presentation, can you do this for me? I can talk to Alexa, all of these things. It's a connected hub so that we can use all of this information and share it and actually leverage it in ways that we don't while we're in silos. So what does that look like? That looks like this, which is our technology stack. and which is the future of smart buildings. So Schneider Electric has this in all of our literature, and this is our solution right now. It is the platform for a smart building of the future. And the big difference here is we still have all the connectivity we showed previously. But that platform are third-party products that we can connect to at the field level. It's other types of systems that we can integrate to at the edge level, whether that's the hotel management service or property management, Lyft, visitor management. And then a platform for us to develop patents so that we could use Smart Connector and things like that and create those third-party apps. The thing about the iPhone and the smartphones that's so great is that Apple's not the one developing those apps. They just build the infrastructure. They don't have the resources to develop all those apps. They need people to come, smart people, use their platform because it's great. And that's what we're laying out here at Schneider, is this platform that we can use, ultimately work with more parties and make buildings more interconnected and smart. And what does that mean when we look back at the end stakeholders of buildings? I want to start with customer experience, because I'd like to reiterate that I think it's all about the customer moving forward. We need to be thinking about that customer experience. As customers, or employees, or tenants, in a smart building, we can no longer ask for too much. If something happens and your tenant, 5 years into a lease that you have with them, says, I need this, it's all the rage, it's the new thing that everybody has, with a connected smart building, you have the platform and infrastructure that you can bring that in. If you're siloed, and we do that the old way, in terms of designing projects now, we run the risk of being the critical reason that we can't do some of these things. That happens today as we design these buildings. So we can't ask for too much about that as customers. As facility managers, we get those superpowers. So the things that we were looking at day to day at the edge level, we can now gain all the insights we want from lots of different types of cloud analytic platforms or analyzing what's happening at scale, not just in VAS. But also in security, elevators, whatever. We can start gathering insights by making those connections, similar to that kind of brain that I showed with the neurons and axons. And then lastly, the stakeholder, the person who's looking for ROI, the building owner, this is a revenue opportunity, a business venture. We get closer to our customers. When you're closer to your customers, that means you learn more about your customers. When you learn more about your customers, it means you learn more about what's valuable for them. And that's the key. When you know what's valuable to customers, you can attract new customers and bring them in, or you can retain your customers. That's the most valuable customer you have is the one you've already got, right? So you can retain them, learn about them, and start figuring out ways to provide new value. If you can provide value, you can fix revenue to them. So for building owners, we should be looking at smart buildings, not just as a way to be more efficient, but a way for us to gather more insights that let us know more about each customer at a granular level and figure out ways to potentially make more money and revenue. So that leads us to the call to action. Call to action. I love this quote. Never change things by fighting existing reality. You change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. And that's really what we're tasked with now. What we're looking at is, okay, we've got this thing that might be pretty important. What do we do about it? And the first question is this optional? Can I avoid it, right? Is the third wave of technology and this customer trend, is it going to seep into buildings? And my answer to that is the demographics say no. Technology waves and what we've seen in buildings in the past says no. The concept of the 1-9-90 and where the revenue comes from says no. Facility management, who's always going to want better technology, is going to say no. And that customer experience opportunity that's out there everywhere, which we've seen play out in all of those company examples that I shared, says no. And also, companies like Fortune Magazine, which should raise our eyebrows. When Bloomberg and Fortune Magazine are talking about smart buildings and connectivity, they say no. And I'd just like to read this quote, because it's really resonant with what we've been talking about. Historically, designers have focused their attention on the product's form and function. While that still matters, of course, the definition of a meaningful user experience has expanded significantly and will continue to do so. Instead of creating a single product, designers will need to imagine a suite of connected products and services that have awareness of each other and their surroundings. Stake a claim now in the space where digital and physical disappear, and products and services mimic and react to our natural behaviors. And that really shows kind of what we've been talking about. This first sentence, think about the Motorola Razr versus the smartphone, going away from just that product. And then going from meaningful user experience, and think about all those companies that are battling the same thing right now. And then instead of creating a single product in the silo, start thinking about the connected hub. And then lastly, that third wave of technology that we haven't quite seen yet, but we're on the cusp of, literally, where digital and physical disappear, which I believe I described as it's starting to get harder to tell where humans end and technology begins. It's going to start making it difficult to tell where our traditional HVAC designs or lighting designs end and that digital appears. So I would share this video. It's 4 minutes. I'm not going to. This is the Bloomberg video of the Edge. The Deloitte Edge building in Amsterdam. It shows kind of some of the building of the future that is connected on a digital hub. And then what I would like to do if I come in with, I don't know why this is happening. There we go, AV systems of the future, right? Projecting. Anyway, if we're local and I'm with a customer somewhere, we can offer up kind of experience, those use cases that are so valuable that we've done already, we've proven it out. Here's how the process works, here's how long it took, here's what we've got, here's what they use. Really good opportunity to work with customers on that. It speaks a lot. And then how do we get there? So I wanted to focus a lot on kind of the macro trends and what's in front of us for this presentation here today. And I'm going to connect with Warren because a lot of his how do we get there was embodied in his presentation about smart hospitals. But really, there's two different ways to go about it, philosophically and technically. Philosophically, inclusion, cooperation, and partnership in early is exactly what he was talking about with 2 years before this thing comes out. We need to be on the design team. We need to be the visionaries. People who are in this field need a larger role and more of an inclusion in what's actually happening with the technology in the building because it's that important. Philosophically, specification, converged network, division 25, just as Warren said. He's 100% right about that. We need to be looking at converged networks and specifically putting those use cases into specifications so that we have the big players bidding on these digital hubs. As opposed to division 23 and all these separate things that naturally generate silos and divisions of responsibility, smart buildings are much more of a platform, much more of a hub. In terms of technically, networking is going to become much more critical. So Warren had that slide about the WAN and those networks that are on there. We need to be involved with IT personnel much more than we have been in the past. And along with that, as we start to allocate more of our value and interest in technology, we can't sleep at all on cybersecurity, and it's something that we all need to be aware of. It's an evolving threat that will continuously change. And as we become more and more dependent on these technical platforms and software driving cars and running grids and running streets and running buildings, we have to be ahead of cybersecurity. So these are kind of the big macro trends of what I feel coming out of this presentation I'd like to talk to you all more about with the local office that executes that, so that this Project X that I'm in here to talk about today, we can use that as a case study to say, can we make this real? What kind of things would you be interested in terms of smart buildings? And does it resonate with you? So hypothetically speaking, I'd probably be called in to talk about the project or whatever. That's how we get there. That's what I think the action items would be in the next steps. And then lastly, I'd like to share that with what I do with the consulting engineering team, we have a platform that's dedicated to informing the engineering and technical community. We call it Proficient because we want to be out ahead of this. We want to share this information. We're a leader in terms of connectivity and digital Internet of Things in the building space. So we'd love access for everybody to testimonial videos, specs like Division 25, data sheets. Please go and view that. Talk to the people that are laying out and designing your systems about that. We feel that we're the knowledge center. We'd like to be brought in an earlier place so that it's not just bid out and we're going low bid, value engineering. There's too much to be lost moving forward in terms of operating expenses in the digital future with customers. So in conclusion, as I thank you for your time, what I'd like to say is black screen. Now what I'd like to say is hopefully what we've done is distill the difference between really technologically cutting edge modern buildings and what smart buildings actually are. And hopefully we've indicated why that's such an important trend, not just in the things that we spend most of our time with in our industries that we're familiar with, that water that we're constantly swimming in, but the world around us and how we can't do anything but expect that that's going to work into buildings. So ultimately, now that we know what those trends are and what smart buildings are versus modern buildings that we've all been familiar with, there are action items that I would like to take in terms of future meetings or discussions or what have you in terms of talking about Spec Division 25. We're talking about specific use cases that you might like in the project that you're working on. And ultimately, I leave with control your own destiny or someone else will. I don't believe that this is that optional. I think smart buildings are here. Jack Welch was pretty good. The value of General Electric while he was the CEO went up 4,000% under his tenure. So I think that we need to take a look at this and make sure that we're in control of it. Thanks. I'll open it up for questions.
Yeah, let's take about 10 minutes for questions. And the same thing, if it's okay with you, we'll additionally send you others that come in. Go ahead. Happy to hear from you.
You were talking about bridging the gap between digital and physical, right?
Yes.
You started to talk about that a little bit. And you're like, oh, this is coming. I mean, so there's actually an industry, physical web, that has essentially done it, you know? And so, and it's something I think is going to be a topic of discussion for us in the near future. Because we're talking about, you know, augmented reality. You mentioned it in your presentation. It's like, are you thinking about these things wherever you're talking to people? You're talking about it as if it's coming, but it's already here.
Yeah, that's a good point. It is already here, and the second time I give this presentation, I'll make sure to be clear about that.
Yep. Sure.
But yeah, no doubt. That stuff's here. Pokemon Go.
Think about beacons, right? That's exactly what you're explaining, man. And then you talk about apps, you know, another thing. We talk about native apps. You talk about, you know, what's our app platform?
Yes.
Adapt the apps, right? Yes. We're at progressing apps, yes. You know.
I think it depends on your audience, right? Like some of this construction VPs, executives, they don't know it's here.
Well, this is tailored. Yeah. I mean, this is an A&E presentation for the most part.
This could be. I mean, I would feel comfortable end user, developer, general contractor, engineer. I think, obviously, Warren hit on this. It's a hypothetical presentation.
Yeah.
So there's some, like, I think innate things going on in your mind when you know exactly who you're talking to and what's going to resonate with them. But yeah, you're going to tailor that message to whoever. It is, yeah. I mean, it's much more exciting than, you know, simply HVAC control when you start thinking about software and where we plan to
go. I love how you're trying to put the focus back on customer experience or user experience. You call it customer experience, I call it user experience.
I don't think there's a choice, dude. I really think that basically as fast as technology has moved, and like I mentioned a couple of those apps, I know you've heard me say this, but like household names like Instagram or something like that, or Snapchat, are literally like 3 years old, or 5 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So you're making a pretty risky bet if you don't believe that that stuff is going to continue to seep into what we just expect out of our day-to-day,
yeah.
Particularly for little kids now who have never known anything different.
I call your quotes.
Me too.
There were a lot of them, yeah.
Yeah.
First off, good job, especially Fallen Warren, because I wouldn't want to do that. Sitting there still.
Yeah,
so I noticed in comparison a little bit, and not that neither one was better, but I think you did a lot more of getting us as the audience out of their comfort zone. I mean, there's even things in there that I had never thought about where the light bulb goes off. That if we deal with this every day, right? We're in front of these people. We're supposed to know all this stuff. So was your intention to more educate your audience than just bring the actual Schneider directed towards us? Warren's was definitely more Schneider directed, right?
Yes.
Because they have the healthcare. But I feel like yours is more of an audience where you're trying to educate the CNE, right, to let them know, like, what is the future here? Obviously integrating Schneider a little bit, but just felt like a little different platform.
Yeah, so totally towards the end of that presentation, I'd like to build out with more Schneider stuff, and Warren had a lot towards the end there about kind of like the Schneider solution that was good. When you had the silos mixed into one, you know, and the way that Schneider goes about doing it, that will be necessary for the presentation. I think a couple things. Hospitals, it's so important and they're so highly regulated that there hasn't been that much choice in getting up to speed with all of this stuff and getting good at it.
Right.
With the commercial office building and all these other types of buildings and our industry in general, we're often up against inertia of ideas, and this is the way it's been done, and particularly with mechanical engineers, where I think that really the task that I have is to make them a little bit thoughtful or uncomfortable to say, all right, is it okay for me to keep doing this if this is a realistic possibility.
I mean, I think it's great because, like you said, when your first slide was, well, if you sat in a room with a bunch of even end users, VIPs, whatever, everybody's heard smart building for 10 years, right?
Yeah,
you just like, everybody knows it. So your presentation wrapped all in one about the smart building that gave 10 times more things than the smart building could be that I would guess most of these people, not us, but most people would not know about, right? So I think, I think it was a great way to present to a group.
Cool. Thank you.
Last question.
I think Bo made an awesome point. But so you try to define the audience today as it relates to their user, and then you start talking about millennials and Gen Z. So you're making them think about, hey, who is my user 30 years from now? When this investment I'm making today still has to exist. I think that's a common kind of question. The comment is, that's a passion.
And that's what a platform is. Because a platform, you can grow off of a platform over time. As those things come that we can't predict what they'll be. You can grow with it to make sure that you're providing that perceived value of the customer.
Great presentation.
Thanks.
One last question.
Yeah.
So, to build off with